This better? Yeah, okay. So what we do now is, let's have a look at these fully trained networks. I told you before, these are expert brains now, because they have learned. And if you are a doctor, you have, for example, you train for radiology, you have to learn 5 years, and see lots and lots of patients, and after that, yeah, you are an expert. If you do your job for 20 years, you are a senior expert. And you learn more and more, and the more data you learn, the better. So, these networks that are fully trained, they can be downloaded. And many of these networks are now collected. Sorry. I'm drinking bubbles and you don't stay with me. There is a Wolfram neural net repository. And I'll show you what that repository is doing. It's a collection by Wolfram, the maker of Monica. And they have collected quite a few, several dozen, I think it's now at least 40 or 50, of all the famous networks that are around. So this network, ImageNet competition data, was trained by 1.2 million data. And it can perfectly recognize anything you like it, you feed it. So this rhinoceros recognizer you have now for yourself, you download this network and you have it. So you can look through your own database. This is age estimation. It was trained by, I think, 500,000 faces. And they know the age of these faces. And the network learns what is characteristic for your age. Before, we had to design this. We looked at wrinkles, and we looked at the slabs of your cheeks, and so on. Actually, we never could this design very well. We were never complete. You never had the right features. But the neural network just learns the right features. It doesn't learn too many, it doesn't learn too few, it just learns the right features. And I'm going to have a look. If you, for example, click on this, you see that it gives you the full Mathematica code. You download the network, you look into the net model, and you see this is quite a complex network, lots of layers, convolution, pooling. So, wow, it's a big network. But this network was designed by someone else, and you can just download it. And this is quite a big network. You put in an image, and it says, hey, this is 18. And what I go do is show you a couple of these networks. You have the website here. You can have a In the last hour, we're going to do all this. So, I have a couple of demos here. I'd like to show you how it works in real life. So, I start with Monica. We have a fully trained network set. Is it too small, or shall I make it bigger? Okay. Can you read it?
Yeah.
Of course, there's a section here that says I can make it any size, but I think 200% is fine. So I download everything from this resources Wolfram Cloud repository. I set the directory on my notebook directory, so it means everything, images and so on, I have them right there. And let's have a look at this age estimation trained data. So it was tested on 520,000 images of faces. So I first load the resource object. This is now downloaded from the Wolfram website. And let's see what's in there. This is the descriptor of the network. Probably doing some downloading. So what did you show this to someone else that this is okay, I just restart the program. Sorry for this, I don't know what's happening. This
Okay. Network. I never had this before. That's the demo effect. You know what? I agreed with my computer and then this is a brute force solution for me, but something is, I don't know, but I have a class computer, which is okay. Okay, I read the network, and now we see the description of the network. It was trained on 520,000 images of faces, and now this is the net model. This is actually the full network, age estimation, and I download now this. It has 40 layers. The network has been downloaded. And you see all the layers from this network. Convolution, RAMs, so quite a number of layers. And you have in the beginning 224 by 224, so it has all these things. And now we could have a look, for example, this is an image from a famous guy who unfortunately just left. This is him, but we will see this later. He probably knew this, it was coming. So this is Marius, and he was sitting there, and if you then put your own image in there, you can estimate your age. And that's actually quite nice. So you could use the network now for any purpose as you like it. And I want to do some more network examples. This, for example, is the photo to Van Gogh translation. So if I have this network, how is this network? It's a collection of Van Gogh paintings and photos downloaded from Flickr. And if I load this network, it's also quite a big network, 33 layers. But you see how easy it is. You download it from the website and you have now a completely trained network. And these networks have millions and millions of connections already wired in there. So it's a fully trained network. So I have an image here. And I gave this lecture to radiologists, so let's give an image that is famous to radiologists. That is an X-ray room. So you have an X-ray here in the bottom, and this is the detector. and here we have the CT scan. So let's call this IMG, that's the image. So I make this the image. And it is now calculating the Van Gogh style of this image. So the Van Gogh net, you see here Van Gogh net working on this image. This is now the result of how Van Gogh would have painted what he had seen, because you have completely the style, the colors of this. And this is nice. You can use this for all kinds of things. So if you want to use all kinds of arts, these networks are now available. You can actually take them and download them. It goes much further. And this, for example, is colorful image colorization. And what does it mean, colorization? Filling the colors on a black and white image. So again, this is, we call it color net. So we have here net model, and we learn the color net. And here we have the network, very big network as you see, but it was fully trained by color images. And if you put this image in there, so you put the black and white image in, the network has learned that if you see this kind of structure outside of, it has also recognized animal, this can never be blue, this is not the sky, but this must be grass, this must be green. And it has seen thousands of images where it was always green. So let's see what it is doing. It is calculating this, and now you see it is taking this image, and this is what it does. So from a black and white image, you can now make the natural colors, because the network has learned that grass is always green. And people use this now to make black and white movies, to color them, and you don't do this by hand and paint them, because how do we do it? If you saw the dog with the grass, you never would paint the grass pink, or you would make it green, because you have learned that. And these networks learn the same thing. So it's quite nice. I have an image here of Elena. This is Elena. You may recognize her. And it's black and white. So I thought, let's make a test. There's not a single color information here. And now we ask the system to color this in. So we do the net evaluation on this particular image. And this is what it makes. It's astonishing. The lips are dark red. It is maybe not identical and not perfect, but it is a very nice human filling in of colors, because it learned it. And you need enough learnings to do that. And of course you can do this, every ethnicity has it. If you do this for Chinese people or African people, it all will be different and so on. But it knows how to learn all these features. So you see how powerful this all is. You could even say that if you have a 2D image, you can make a 3D image out of it. So this is a very famous deep learning guy, Prof. He was my PhD student, he was a cum laude PhD student, and he's now the leader of the deep learning, very big deep learning group in the Netherlands. With 35 PhD students, works on healthcare in many fields. And he is quite a famous guy. So the network is now loaded. This is a demo on which we have the the residual network trained on 100 million geotagged data. So we have the data here, and it's quite a big network. And this network is now capable of recognizing any image where it was taken in the world. So that's quite spectacular. I gave this lecture in Utrecht, and this is a picture of the city of Utrecht. This is the cathedral, and now you you put this image in there, and it gives the geoposition. So let's see what this geoposition, these are the northern and western lengths and so on. So you ask in Mathematica, what's the geographics of this position? And it is now looking up, and hey, this says Utrecht. It is exactly it. So it recognized, where is it?
Just one picture.
Just one picture. It learned 100 million pictures. You missed most of the examples, that's a pity, because I showed you.
You don't have the slide?
Yeah, okay, but I missed you. Okay, but here is the geographics where it was. And yeah, this is exactly where it is. So you see the power of all these networks, that it's pretty amazing. You can make color images, etc. You can recognize the age of the guy, all these things. So it's so strong, it is really a very powerful set of demos. And this is the beginning. You can download tens of these images, of tens of these networks. And what I go do in the fourth hour, the last hour, you sit down with Mathematica and you train, you do this yourself. You download these images and you go have a look. Okay, this is the demos. And now we go look into the brain. Now I first want to show you some more on face recognition. Because that is, how does face recognition work? Who's actually working with face recognition? Nobody? But you know how powerful it is. It's really nice. Facebook can recognize more than 97% of faces right, which is extremely good when you compare this with humans. And you have, of course, all these apps. You have the automatic face detection. You see these boxes, and you can do tagging. And that is getting more and more sophisticated. And Facebook is using you all the time. As soon as you click like, you have given permission to Facebook to upload everything of you. So it reads your complete phone, more or less, at every like. You gave the permission in the beginning, you didn't know. So it has an amazing amount of data. And now what you can do is, this was from a medium.com site. Let's see in detail how a deep learning program recognizes faces. And this was a particular challenge in the United States. This was this is a famous actor, and this is a famous rock musician. But they were very, very alike. And how could you find the recognition between these two guys? So what people do is you first find the face in an image, then you analyze these facial features, then you compare with all kinds of known faces, and then you make a prediction. So it's a kind of a regular step. And we want to do all these steps one by one. And as you know, we are incredibly sensitive for faces. I'll show you later discoveries in monkeys that found pathways that are completely dedicated for faces. And these are very strong pathways. You can measure in them, stick a needle in them, and see what they do. And they do active shape and active appearance models. And they're pretty well understood what they do. So let's have a look what happens here. First, we need to find the face in the image. And how can you find the face in the image? You're a computer vision expert. How do we do this? This works on every phone, so
they're working. So they probably use every phone, so they probably don't use a neural net at this point. They use Haar wavelets with Violin Jones or...
Yeah, something
what
like
is
that.
I don't know what the baseline is for this, for the phones. But today, you can actually use a neural net.
of course, but they neural networks mostly on the already selected area. So let's have a look at what is selection, how that could be done. It should be done on very tiny hardware, because in these cameras like this, you cannot put much hardware. It's a very, very tiny processor, and your phone is also very limited. So let's have a look. Fiora and Jones, they invented a very nice way to detect faces. I'm not going to talk about it, that was actually the very first breakthrough. But there came a new breakthrough, and that was a method invented by Dalal. It was invented in 2005. Let's have a look at this.
Dalal and Tricks.
Dalal and Tricks, and it's a very famous paper. And they call this histogram of oriented gradients for human detection. And this paper was easy to read. So every student read this paper, and they looked at histogram of gradients, and I could explain a little bit what this histogram of gradients is. And the paper was so famous that it is today already cited 25,000 times. Well, that's ridiculous. If your paper gets so famous, let's have a look at Google Scholar. If you look at Google Scholar, you see all these images, and here you have Dalal and Tricks. Today it is cited 25 times, 974 times. Okay.
That's amazing.
That's pretty amazing. And why is it so popular? Because it works so well.
I think the SIFT paper has even more citations.
Well, okay. This is SIFT. It is with the multi-scale extrema. Yeah. It is SIFT. So it is.
David Lowe is...
I worked a lot with David Lowe. We did exactly the same thing for many years. We improved this method. I'll show you that later. So histogram of gradients was extremely well working. And later we will see, does the brain this too? Can we find this in the brain? Because this is so clever. Did the brain invent this too? Let's have a look. And so what we do is a histogram of gradients. Well, what's a gradient? A gradient is actually an edge detection. So you look at a pixel, and you're going to look at what is the difference of my pixel with my neighbors. I have 8 neighbors, so with every neighbor I can make a difference. So I have actually 8 different, small differences, and these differences are called the gradients. So you have a very tiny star of differences. And that star of differences is more or less the oriented gradients. You can make the star a little bit bigger, you can take 3x3, 4x4, 16, 5x5, so you make a little bit larger regions, you have more of these little gradients, you have more. And if you have all these gradients, you put them in the histogram. That's the whole trick. So you don't look at pixels anymore. But what you do is you look at the pixel with its surroundings, and every pixel has its own surroundings. And what you then do is you make vectors, the gradients, in all these different directions. And this means I do not look at the pixel itself, but I look at the local structure. So I have the little star, and that star, because it only looks at differences, is invariant for intensity. If I turn the lights on, all my pixels change. So everything changes. So what is my computer vision computer program doing? It's terrible though my pixels change. But if every pixel gets new light and every pixel goes up 100, and my neighbor 2, the difference is still the same. So these differences are very stable for all kinds of changes. So if the sun is covered by a cloud, you get different intensities. It doesn't matter. So it is very stable, robust. And that is actually the main thing from this histogram of gradients. So here we change the intensity, and you see that the histogram of gradients, they remain the same. So now, here we have all these little stars. And you see, you don't have to calculate these stars at a very high resolution. And that's another trick. People do this every, let's say, 25 pixels. So we have a very low resolution measurement. And we will see later that your retina is also making a very low resolution measurement. It doesn't measure at every pixel. Because all we need to know is that this area here is more or less the eye. And you see this is more or less the eye. Here we have the nose. In this area there is no change. Nothing happens here.
because this is a homogeneous area. There are no gradients. So it's actually not interesting. There is no structure. We only want to see places where there is structure. So now I make a histogram, a gradient picture of lots and lots of faces. So this is more or less the average histogram of gradient figure for a face. If I use this as a template and I convolve my image with this, I can easily find it that this pattern only occurs here. And because I have only 25 by 25 pixels, it's extremely fast. I don't need to do this by a million with a million pixels. No, I do this with a very low subsampling. So I can very easily find, and this is the way how you find the location of a face. You don't need to find upside down faces because they don't exist. You always find faces with the eyes on top. So you find the right pattern. It's quite straightforward. So now we find the faces in these images. And then you need to find faces that are independent of the orientation. So my face, if I look in this way, or that way, it's still the same face. So how can you make a computer program that doesn't care about what is the projection angle? So these are the same guys with the same different directions. And what people now do is you can find 68 feature points. So these are two feature points on the ridge of the nose. These are around the mouth. And you can learn the system to find them. It's a very nice method. And I'll show you this in one part of the program, how to find these. And these 68 specific points, you number them. There's point zero to all the way to the end. If you have these points, you have more or less this outline. You now need to register this outline to the front outline. So you need to find a transformation to make it straight. And if I have a transformation, for example, this is oblique and now I go straight, that's a linear transformation. It's called an affine transformation. In the mathematics of that is quite simple. You just deform it in such a sense you actually make from a specific shape, you make a straight shape. So if you have this face from the side, you put it straight, and you see the face in this case that is deformed, but you now look from the front. That's called an affine transformation. And affine transformations are simple, they are linear, they include rotations, translations, and scale. And this is what actually happens. You sometimes see it in CSI, these crime scene investigations that people measure a face, then you do a match. But let's have a look how it does this in this deep convolutional neural networks. This, all these specific points can be found by a trained deep neural network on these faces. And what people now do is, you have these points, and now we have to recognize which face is it. And then you have to compare your outline of these points with, is it the right face or is it the wrong face? So what people do is they say, I have a face here, or have a face here, and I tested both with the right face, and here is another face, or I tested with the wrong face and another face, and if it is compared with the right face, you improve the network, you adjust it. And if you compare it with the wrong face, you reject it. So it's actually a double-sided test what you do. And this works actually quite nice. It takes a long time because they do this with, I don't know, millions of images, thousands of different people. It takes days. And then you find all these different measurements on these 128 different images from faces. And you really don't know what these 128 different measurements or features, what they mean. It's a descriptor for a face. It's actually a point in a 128 dimensional space. There is that face. And if you find the same face, it's pretty close to that point. And another face is right here. And nobody knows what these points really mean. But you can learn them, and you can actually make huge databases with all these different points. Because this space is so incredibly big, you can have quite a number of faces in there. And now,
you need to find the specific name of this patient, and then you need a simple classifier. So in the feature space, you're going to make divisors, boxes, and people normally take a support vector machine classifier. That's a very powerful classifier. And then you see this here running on the video. These two guys were actually invited for a show in the United States. And the system was real-time capable of recognizing those two guys separately from each other, even from the presenter. And face recognition is today completely solved. It's quite nice. And the tagging can be done very well. It is, of course, a very powerful application that everybody wants to have. So now we see a little bit the background of this face recognition. Are there any questions so far? Do I go too fast, too slow? Is it okay?
It's okay.
Yeah? Okay. Because I want to go a little bit deeper in what has been found in the brain. And then we go see what we can learn from this for computer vision and deep learning. I call it neuromathematics because it's actually finding out what these functional networks do. And what I'd really like to get to is bridge human vision and deep learning, because the deep learning people in general know nothing about vision, and the vision people know nothing about the mathematics of deep learning. It's amazingly disparate, separate. Have you ever heard of a stellate endocrine cell? Yeah? What does it do?
I'm not sure. I don't remember.
Okay.
So, what did you tell me more about it?
I can talk more about it.
Okay.
You have 100 million of these cells in your retina.
Okay, so you are talking about not the cones and rows, the ones above, right? They do this Gabor filtering style, or maybe some kind of high-level processing of textures.
Gabor filters are completely out.
But they look like Gabors, at least.
Yeah, they look like Gabors, but I'll tell you
not
more
all
about
the way.
Okay, so we have a little bit of these different fields that people know a little bit about it, but not the real thing. And the other way around, if you ask a biologist what is a principal eigenvalue or the principal component in eigenvalue analysis, I've heard about it but doesn't know. So the revolution in brain research is as spectacular as the revolution in deep learning, and that's indeed true. There's an amazing amount of new techniques, optogenetics, adaptive optics, fantastic calcium fluorescence imaging, we have nanoscale imaging, we do functional imaging. It's pretty amazing. And people just don't know, but I'll tell you a little bit about it. And because you are here biomedical engineering, you can actually, you are the right people to be in this field today, because you do both. You speak a little bit bio and a little bit engineering, so that means you have a little bit of both of the fields. My department in Eindhoven is the biggest in the Netherlands. We have 1,000 biomedical engineering students, and we have 200 new students every year. Everybody gets easily jobs. It's fascinating. They go to hospitals where they have big groups now where they assist the doctors. So the integration of biomedical engineering and medical is already pretty far, and I really hope to see this will happen in Romania too. That the doctors need you, that they will get you on board. The doctors need to work with all this deep learning. They don't know how to do it. So you should be part of their teams and discuss with them what software should you buy, what can we develop with your data, etc. So we will look at the layers of the visual system. And I told you before, we have the retina here. The retina is amazingly complex. It's not just rods and cones. Actually, people forget about the retina is not a camera at all. This is a basic camera, but there's a lot of processing already there. V1, V2, etc. And we're going to look at all these deeper layers. So what do we do today in imaging the brain? All of us know MR. This is my own brain. And you see the different slices. And it's pretty low resolution. It's about half a millimeter.
It looks nice, but it's pretty limited. You have cubes, so it's, let's say, 5,012 by 5,012 by 5,012. CT scan the same, that's about 1,000 square, but it's a pretty low resolution. These are megapixel images. It's called magnetic resonance imaging, and we have today also functional MRI. A functional MRI is a little bit different. It looks at oxygen, and if I have, for example, this image, I stimulate a guy with a flickering checkerboard, and that means all the cells in my visual system are active, they use energy, and when the cell uses energy, it signals to the capillaries, the small blood vessels, please open and give me more blood, more oxygen. And that means this area, it is energetically so active, needs more oxygen, gets more oxygen. And oxygen is a paramagnetic substance. You can see a very tiny difference in a pixel when there is more oxygen or when there is less oxygen. So you first scan the patient while he's doing nothing. You scan the back of his head. And then you give him the checkerboard and then his cells are active. And then these MR images are a tiny difference, but you subtract them. And then you see the differences. And now you see the differences are in the back. So now with this technique, you can see where is the brain active? Where do I solve a crossword puzzle? Where do I have perception of sound? Where do I feel pain? And the mapping of the brain today is rather complete. We know for tiny detail what is happening where because of this functional MRI. It's a very nice technique.
So it's analyzing over time?
Yeah, it's analyzing over time, so you do a stimulus, you have to give quite a number of stimuli, but it's incredibly sensitive, and it's a big hype in psychology, what happens where. You have voltage-sensitive dyes. That's a pasta that you put on the brain, and it gives a fluorescent marker, a fluorescent light effect, if a cell gives an action potential. You have 100,000 of cells here, and they all fire, and how can you measure them? You can stick a needle in there. Maybe you can stick a needle in 10, but that's about it, or 100. But you want to see all these billions of cells firing, but now you can see them firing.
Excuse me, just one question. For functional MRI, what would be the resolution at the neural level? How many neurons do you catch in one spot?
Oh, this resolution is about 1 millimeter.
1 millimeter, so that's
you don't see one
thousands of, hundreds of
oh,
thousands
yes,
of neurons.
Oh, yes, it's pretty rough. This is very detailed and real time, but you cannot do this with humans. You have to open the skull and you have to put this on the experimental animal, but then you can really see the activity of how the brain is firing. This is, in my group, we worked on this a lot. This is brain connectivity. You can see the wires in the brain. We can do this only since about 10 years. It's a very special MRI technique. It's called diffusion-weighted MRI. And we can now beautifully see the connections in the brain. And how does it work? We look at the tiny motion of water molecules. And they bump into each other. They make vibrating motion. And these are very, very tiny motions. But the field in an MRI scan is not homogeneous. It is 3 tesla. But to the left it is 2.9 tesla. And here it is 3.1 tesla. So there's an increase in the magnetic field. It's called a gradient. So if these tiny water molecules move a little bit around, they go from low magnetic field to high magnetic field, very tiny, they change frequency. And these frequency changes can be measured. So we measure them, how they move. We do this for X, Y, and Z. And then we know exactly how they move.
Have you, can you tell us, or maybe if you know more about spintronics, is there something that rings a bell about this? The spin of these very small particles, I don't know, they think of all these nanoscale devices, I don't know how reliable they could be at this level.
Well, MRI only measures the spin, so that's basically MRI.
Yeah, but smaller level devices.
I talk about MRI devices here, and that goes too detailed. We have the motion of water molecules here. And if you restrict the water molecules, for example, they are in the nerve fiber, then they can easily move along the nerve fiber, but not across the nerve fiber. So if you measure them for some time, you see that they not move in a Gaussian blob, but they move like an ellipsoid. So in every pixel, I can measure these ellipsoids, and this is what I measure in an MRI scan. I have millions of these, if it is 1,000 by 1,000 by 1,000, I have a million of these ellipsoids. And you already see that if I connect one by one, and I take the longest axis, I do eigenvalue analysis, so I measure a tensor, this is called diffusion tensor imaging. So I take the longest eigenvector, I connect them, and then you nicely see how the connectivity of the fibers in the brain. So I published lots of papers about this, and we did very nice visualizations for the doctors of how is the wiring in your brain. We programmed everything on the GPU. These are thousands of fibers that connect the left side of the brain to the right side of the brain. We color-coded the fibers with X, Y, Z in the red, green, blue, and you can very nicely now see the wirings in the brain. And you can see the pyramidal tracts, you can see the optic radiation, any fiber in the brain can now be outlined. We did a lot with neurosurgeons. Some people have epilepsy, and if you have epilepsy, then some brain areas are very active, you cannot stop it, and they have all kinds of attacks. And medicine doesn't help anymore. And what people then sometimes do is say, well, because these people are very limited in their life, they cannot go on a bicycle because you can have an attack and you fall. You cannot go swimming because if you get an attack, you drown. So they're desperate. And then they say, okay, let's remove this epileptic focus. And if it is here on the side, it may be that the fibers that go from your eye to your visual cortex, they run sometimes pretty superficial. And some patients, a quarter of them, got blind because they touched the optic fibers. So they asked us, can you design a workstation? And we did, so we found the thalamus. We did the tracking. With fMRI, we found the V1 area. So we could localize in this patient exactly where is the ending of your fibers. We found too many fibers, so we did statistical analysis to limit it to the most probable ones. And now you see, here we have the visualizations in the transparent brain. And now you see that in this patient, we could outline the fibers from the visual system. This is the cortex, here is V1. Here are the eyes. This one is not depicted, but you see this patient was operated just till here, and they didn't touch the fibers of this patient. And now no patient can blind anymore. So we have the function of the brain. We know which area is active, fMRI. We have the connectivity of the brain. And there's a new kit coming, that's optogenetics. And that's quite spectacular. This is the molecule in your rods and cones that is light sensitive. It is living in the membrane. It goes 7 times up and down. And if a photon comes in, this molecule opens. And there's a very small ion flux going in, and then you get a tiny electrical effect, and that is what measures. And you have an incredible amount of these rhodopsin molecules, as we call it.
And they are active if the cell is responding? So if the neuron is active?
No, they're light responsive. So if a photon comes in, they open. And then they open for about 1 millisecond.
And they open more for the neurons that are firing than for the ones that are not? Or
there are no neurons firing here. This is just a molecule. There's not a single neuron involved. This is nothing.
So this is not for imaging the brain?
This
for
is
imaging.
Not a neuron. This is your light-sensitive molecule. Okay. It's living in your rods and cones. And you have billions of these neurons, molecules in your rods and cones.
So this is for visualizing?
This is for visual measurement. This is your sensitive area. Here you measure an electrical signal. People know exactly how all this works. This is the very detailed inside view of one rod. So we have the rods and the cones. And if you study in detail how incredibly beautiful they are made, you need a lot of membrane for these molecules. So nature said, let's make a lot of membrane. So they make a lot of, let's say, coins. We have membranes on top and membrane on the bottom. And they're full with all these sensitive molecules. We have about 10 to the 8 rhodopsin molecules per rod. You have 10 to the 8 rod cells per retina. So you have 10 to the 16th of these molecules in your retina. That's a lot. This is the most sensitive detector that has ever been designed. We cannot make such a sensitive detector of humans. This detects 1 photon per second. And that is amazingly low. So it is staggering how well nature does that. You see how beautifully it is organized. But now comes the trick. They found the DNA from this molecule, pretty complex, and they injected this DNA in the virus. And they put this virus in the mouse brain. And the virus says, yeah, okay, my brain should be in these neurons, in these cells. So it injects, it starts injecting the DNA in these neurons. And these neurons, they have reproducing facilities, they have ribosomes, they read the DNA and they make proteins. So they make these rhodopsin. And this rhodopsin goes in the membrane of the neurons. So these neurons become light sensitive.
Oh, so you can control the mouse.
And you can control the mouse. It is amazing. You can control a single cell. You can control 100 cells. You can control 1 million cells. So they have done some very nice experiments. And here you see the rhodopsin molecule. It lives right here. And this is a photograph of this rhodopsin molecule. This is 1 nanometer. So it is incredibly small, but people can see it. We have these microscopes today. And this mouse has a fiber optic on its head. And when the light is on, it starts running. Because your motor cortex, where all the muscles is here. So your legs are around here. You stimulate with light, and now the light stops, and the mouse stops. So you can turn the mouse on and off. And you can turn much more details now on and off. You can see where the fibers go. So we have incredible detail on how we can study the functions of the brain, the specific subcircuits, what they do. Let's look at the retina. Of course it has rods and cones. I recently wrote a paper why the cone should have a cone shape. And that's very nice mathematics. I cannot tell you about it yet, but it is coming up. It has to do with hyper-resolution. But after the rods and the cones, you see a lot of processing. There are more cells here. Horizontal cells, endocrine cells, bipolar cells. And this is the output cells from the retina. And they have one fiber, each one, there are 1 million of those, and each fiber goes to the brain. So we have 1 million fibers in the optic nerve. Well, we have 150 million detectors, so 150 together come in one cell. So that's actually quite strange. We have not our own cameras, we read every pixel, and we send it to the computer, but the retina does not. And people have studied this for a long time, they put needles in there, and this is the old movies from
the cat.
From the cat, that was from the 50s or the mid-60s. They put all kinds of bars and lines and so on, and they listened, I think, to the sound, isn't it? No, there's no sound, because of this. But anyway, you hear the tick, tick, tick of all these neurons. But this was very long time ago, and it was pretty old-fashioned. But people still teach this, but it is really very primitive. But what they found was that if you stick a needle in one of these cells, you see continuous firing of the cell, and when you illuminate it, you see the same. So it took about 20 years before people understood how is actually the retina activated. And Hubel and Wiesel, they got the Nobel Prize for it. They found that if you just stimulate a very tiny area, then you get the firing. So this is time. You turn the light on here, you get the firing, and when it turns off, you get the regular background again. And they also found that if you have a surrounding, it's negative. It suppresses. Extremely strange. You call it the center surround receptive. So there's nothing to do with pixels. There is a center that's active, and there's a surrounding that's negative.
Like Laplacian.
Yeah, that's the modeling. But that's the classical way, and it was found that you have this model, and we have 50% positive peaks in the middle, and we have 50% negative. And people really don't know why we have 50% negative and 50% positive. So we measured light actually double, twice. And why do we have this on and off? It's very basic, and every animal has it. So if you have a rod and a cone, it splits in a positive signal, and it splits in a negative signal. Is there anybody who knows why we have this?
Well, with this we can detect blobs very well, right? I mean, this is scarcely stereo.
No.
You can detect blobs.
Yeah, that's the old-fashioned
scale space.
That's the old-fashioned theory, which we now try to use.
It's good theory, the Lindenberg's theory.
But why is not a single manufacturer of cameras using it?
Well, this is for processing, it's not for taking pictures.
But why?
It's a higher level of above pixels, right?
So why is not a single camera maker making a camera like the retina?
So, as you said, retina is very complex. We're not able to.
We are. Just let me explain a little further. Well, this has always been a mystery, whether we have plus and minus, and I have some ideas. If you have plus and minus, if you add them, you get zero. But if you delay one, you get frame subtraction. So if you have the frames of a video, and you say, I have frame 1 minus frame 2, and frame 2 minus frame 3, and 3 minus frame 4, etc. You do subsequent frame subtraction. You only look at differences. And I think that these both signals go to the brain. And one signal is delayed, but it's not delayed in the retina, that's why we never measure it. It's delayed in the cortex. And then we have full control of the delay. Now what happens if you look at a delayed movie? This is a movie in which I do subsequent frame. You only see differences. And this is extremely energy saving. Because all these pixels that are the same, why should you process them? You just store them and you remember them and that's fine. You only have to update with the difference. And I think that vision is doing that.
So could you explain how you process this? So you filter with one Laplace and
then you subtract frames that are just next door.
Ah, okay.
So frame J plus 1 minus frame J. Mm-hmm. And this is actually what every observance camera does.
If you have a camera,
no, not background subtraction, this is just change detection. Because you don't know what is the background, this is change detection. And this means that if there is a camera looking at the gate, and the whole day there's nothing happening, the camera sees zero. But now there's an intruder coming in, then something happens. So you only want to see change. So I think this is an extremely effective way of why the retina, and this happens in insects, in all mammals that we know. It's very, very basic. So that's this, for example, is a famous example of what people, most animals, they stand still. If you see animals, they sometimes move shaky, because while they are still, they are less likely to be observed, because you only see differences. If these animals move, you see them immediately, but of course, this one here and this one there, you have to look quite some time before seeing them, but if they move, you easily find them. We have stabilized retinal images, and that means if you have an image that is completely frozen, your retina is continuously moving a little bit. You don't know that, but we have to keep moving. This is what you see if you look at a green screen and you have a red point on top. If you have a stabilized image, after some time it completely disappears. And then it completely disappears into gray. If you look at the red screen and you have a green point on top, it disappears. This is happens if you completely block your eye movements. So we have a filling in effect. We only look at the contours and we fill in this red into the whole area. So we use this, and we could nicely, because the brain does the same, you have all these blood vessels on your retina, but you just don't see them because they are static. If they were moving, you could see them. And if you have a flashlight and you shine a little bit on different directions, and the shadow of these blood vessels is moving, you see perfectly all the blood vessels because they move. As long as they are stable, they are subtracted, and you don't see them. So we could subtract all these vessels very nicely, and if you subtract the blood vessels, you can see microbleedings much more easily. Okay, this was a little bit on brain imaging, on optogenetics. What do I do in time?
Sir, I'm hard of hearing, you have a voice very, I don't know how to say it. Maybe you should write the word so I could, I don't know how to...
Should I speak louder or...
Not louder.
Shorter?
Crispier.
crispier.
like the reporter.
Changing the accent. Change a little bit the accent.
Like a news reporter.
Well, I suggest that you pick your chair and go sit over there and watch my face. You see my lips moving.
Do some breathing.
Do a little breathing. I can try to speak Romanian.
I'm struggling to understand, but just under the paper to understand.
But move your chair, go over here. You're closer. I'll do my best. Tell these things earlier, not at the end of the lecture, but halfway, so we can easily change.
So these changes that you show, these are really interesting. There are these new cameras right now that are based exactly on changes. They only capture changes.
Camera 2 is ready for decades. It was already done in the 40s in the war.
But I've seen all these novel computer vision techniques that are based on these cameras that detect only the changes. If something changes, then you have...
This is so old because it's so simple. You subtract the frames. It's very, very simple. Let's make a small break because I see it is I did again 15 minutes. The next will be on geometric models. So I go again a step a little bit deeper. Can we understand what we're talking about? Why do we have you filter?
There is a term in acting to bite the words.
Right. Can you bite the word and show me how you do it?
Huh?
How do you bite the word?
If I can bite the word, alright. Maybe, I'm not sure about the effect of biting the words, but there are high-pitched sounds that needed to be differentiated when the pronunciation is happening.
It's difficult for me to speak, then we need some filter in the amplifier. But again, my last remark is change your seat and try it again. I cannot speak differently.
You're suggesting me to switch places?
I cannot speak differently, so if you want to hear it, you have to do something else. Okay, let's take a break.
So the cameras are seeing they're called band cameras. With the dynamics and they are useful.